Hello and welcome back to Proactive New York. I'm Christine Corrado. With me right now is Ben Feferman from Amuka Esports. Ben, great to see you. How are you?
I'm doing good, thanks. And yourself?
I'm good, thanks for asking. Ben, esports has seen viewership surge quite a bit during the coronavirus pandemic, especially. You play in this space. Can you first tell me a bit about the company?
Yeah, sure. Amuka Esports, we're Canada's leader in esports venues, leagues, and tournaments. So we build physical spaces where gamers can come in, they can play, they can compete, they create, they can do sort of everything game-related under one roof.
This is a very integrated model. Can you kind of talk about the advantages to that? And actually building these arenas, I can imagine they could potentially be quite expensive since they are so large.
Yeah, build-out costs are expensive. We use, and most venues we use, high-end PCs. That definitely are a big part of the cost. Typically, let's say a 3,000 to 4,000 square foot gaming venue with maybe 20 computers, you're looking at anywhere from $150,000 to $250,000 build-out cost. As you get into larger esports arenas like the one we have, you're definitely $500,000 to $1 million to build something out like that. So the cost is there, but we want to provide a premium gaming experience. So we're not just an internet cafe. We're an esports arena where people can compete with the best in the world live on stage and broadcast all across the world.
Yeah. Why is it important to have that integrated model?
Yeah, I think, a good example is Tuesdays. We have a sports league where people play NHL and FIFA. So you could play these games at home. You could play on your Xbox. So why are you going to go out and spend $10 or $20 to enter a tournament when you can play with your friends at home? So the big difference is experience. When you join our sports league, you're competing on stage with the lights. We have casters, play-by-play. Christine dumps the puck in, chases across the board. So we give everyday gamers the ability to feel like pros on the regular. And that's why people come back, is for that unique gaming and pro gaming experience. Otherwise, if it was just about the game, for sure, I would just say, go play at home and save your $10 or $20.
Yeah, and as I mentioned, we're really seeing a surge in viewership because of the pandemic. What's your kind of forecast for the esports market looking forward?
Yeah, I think, if pre-COVID esports was weird and nerdy, post-COVID esports is cool and understood. So that the big winner, I just think, is our ability as an industry. We've really changed so many minds. We've really moved, non-endemic brands are now interested in investing in the esports industry. There's way more overlap and movement from traditional sports into esports and others, musicians, celebrities, et cetera. Everyone's moving in. So, officially, I've seen some early reports on the size of the industry, which would remain kind of flat in 2020, largely because there is a bit of a loss from all the live events that are going to be canceled. So I think for 2019, the esports industry was about $1.1 billion. And right now forecasts are looking like $1.2 billion for 2020. So headline number is not going to be great, but given COVID and most industries are going down, the fact that esports will remain steady or even with a slight increase is outstanding. And just to the numbers, they came out recently. We saw some year-over-year figures. Twitch, YouTube gaming, Facebook gaming, explosive growth. Anywhere from 60 to Facebook was up almost 250%. Audience is there. The only loser is really Microsoft's Mixer, which was really flat year over year.
Well, Amuka seems like it has some great plans for strategic growth here. This month, you announced that you're raising $500,000 in a private placement on Deal Square. Tell me a bit more about this platform. I'm not super familiar with it.
Sure. My business partner and I, we actually do have a investment banking background. We even have a dealer, a private market dealer. So we could process trades and, with investors ourselves. But at the end of the day, we really just want to focus on what we are good at, and that's building this esports org. And so Deal Square and its sort of sister company, Front Funder, which for retail investors, really enables us to focus on what we want to do, is keep building venues, leagues, and tournaments, and they take care of the entire back end. So all of our DD, our whole data room, all of our due diligence, everything is up on those platforms. It's Front Funder for retail investors can invest, I think, as little as $250. And Deal Square is for brokers and sort of high net worth accredited investors. can access, you know, private deal flow right from the site and transact and get their sub doc signed and everything.
Seems like an interesting platform. When are you expecting to close the financing, and what are you using the funds towards?
Yeah, we expect to close the financing probably within the next 30 to 45 days. Use of proceeds, a big part of it's going to be some facility upgrades to our flagship location in Toronto. You know, right now, for example, we sell a lot of Red Bull and jerky and chips, but we would sell a lot of burgers and fries and beer if we had a full service restaurant and kitchen. So our food and beverage category is still strong, but we think we could quadruple that number with the proper food and beverage options. Also, you know, tournaments are long. People are there for 6, 7, 8 hours sometimes. Like they're going to eat several meals. And the other category that we want to be able to get in on is actually viewing parties. So just like Saturday night, you're going to get together. You're going to watch. Where are you from, Christine? Are you from New York? Or
I'm from New York, yes.
I was going to say you're going to watch the Knicks on Saturday, but I know you're not watching the Knicks.
No.
But maybe some good New York sports teams. Maybe you'll watch the Nets or the Rangers. It's the same thing for us. You know, we want people to come in and watch the Toronto Defiant and Toronto Ultra, the, you know, support the Toronto esports teams. And we need more of a bar infrastructure to do that.
Well, along these lines, I know you're also planning for a potential IPO. What does that look like? I'm sure you can't divulge much, but what can you tell me?
Yeah, sure. We hope to hit the public markets as early as maybe Q4 of this year, or maybe that'll lead into Q1 of next year. There's three main reasons that we feel it's the right strategy to go public. Number one, being on a public exchange raises the profile of your company. So just being out there, you're covered. You're out there for everyone to see. So it's good. Also, you know, we do a lot of M&A, whether it's acquiring venues, whether it's going to be acquiring leagues or tournaments. It's very hard to do M&A with a private currency. So to have a liquid stock available to do some deals is really going to help. And the third reason, which actually is really not talked about a lot, I'm not sure why, but I think going public really is an insurance policy. If you're a private company and, you know, stuff hits the fan and it's not working out and you have to do a down round, like, good luck seeing how many of your private investors or VCs are going to stick by you. Like, everyone's going to be running for the hills. When you're a public company, okay, you do a private placement, you have to raise at a lower price, your stock takes a hit, but you get another kick at the can. And with small caps in Canada, they get a lot of kicks at the can. So I'm not saying that's the reason to go there, but it is nice to know that, you know, if we do, you know, run into a wall, we still have a lot of options.
Well, really, really great to learn more about the company, Ben. Really appreciate it. Thanks so much.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thanks for having me.